Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Environment Committee on Thursday, the 9th of December, 2021. We start with a bit of housekeeping. If there is a fire alarm, please make your way to the nearest fire exits on either side. Please make sure your mobile phone is switched off or on silent. This meeting will be recorded for live and subsequent broadcast, except to the extent there are confidential items, but I don't think we've got any of those tonight. So if you're in the chamber, you are consenting to being filmed. If this is the problem, come and have a chat with Becky. If you are moving around, if you wouldn't mind using your mask, please, but you don't need to wear one when you're seated unless you'd like to. If you wish to speak, please raise your hand, and don't forget to turn your microphone off when you've finished. If you haven't already, please pop your delegate card into the slot with your name facing you. And as we go through, if you're referring to a particular report or slide, if you could just make clear which one you're referring to so that everybody in the chamber and at home knows what you're talking about. And for members, when you come to leave, if you wouldn't mind checking your pigeonhole for post, that would be great. Right. In front of you, members, on your desks, there's an information briefing from Conrad Moore, which covers the progress on all of the mitigation strategies. So that's Rodborough Common, the Severn Estuary, and Cotswold Beechwoods. Brendan, do you have anything to add on that?
Thank you, Chair. Nothing major. I guess the important point is that those three mitigation strategies will all be coming back through this committee during the course of the next 12 to 18 months. So I think that'll be a really useful exercise for the committee to review those strategies and debate them. Thank you.
Yes. Hayden.
Thanks, Chair. Can I just comment on that now? I think under the work programme it is mentioned, but do you want me to comment now or later?
Now will be fine if you'd like to.
Thanks for this, Conrad. Sorry, Brendan. And you and I and Mark have met previously about this. I'm not content the timescales on this. It's suggesting spring 2023 for the Severn Estuary mitigation strategy. 2017 this started. Other councils had people on the ground working, doing education and advice in 2017. So this is suggesting 6 years later we're going to be doing that. I don't think that's acceptable, and I think we need to work harder and get something going sooner than that. When I met with you in October, I think it was, Mark said he was investigating at the time, together with Forest of Dean Council, starting a recruitment process for an officer. He said that then. I don't know if you want to comment on that now, but I really do think this is too long and we need to speed this up.
Thank you. Brendan, do you want to say anything now?
I'll need to consult with Conrad and Mark a bit further on that one, Hayden, if you don't mind. And I think I would say that there has been work since 2017. There's been a strategy in place. It's not that nothing has been happening since then. But the briefing note that you have there describes an approach that's going to involve working with the neighbouring authorities as well, of course, which makes sense when you're looking at a feature like the Severn Estuary, and so that's going to take a little time, and that's why it's not just a Stroud District Council initiative. It's going to be involving those other agencies and other authorities along the estuary. Work will continue in the meantime. It's not as if things are frozen in time whilst we're waiting for that strategy to come forward. But if you'll allow me to just consult with Mark and Conrad a little further on that timetable and see whether that can be brought forward. But a lot of it is not just dependent on Stroud District Council. I hope you'll understand that. Thank you.
Thank you. Is that right? Yes, of course.
Thank you for that, Brendan. And yes, you're aware that I understand it's got to be South Gloucestershire Council in particular, but Forest of Dean as well, because it's the whole estuary we need to be looking at. I still think it needs to be brought forward quite quickly. When we've discussed this in the round before, and Councillor Kay was involved at the time, we wanted a bit of a panel with members' involvement, even if it's only a small group, to help guide this. And I'd be really keen that we are involved at an early stage so that we can make this work. That's how other councils have done it. As I say, they're with Estuarine and Triple SIs and what have you, Solent, X, Thames and elsewhere. And I really do think a small group of people probably drawn from this committee would be useful. But I'm happy to work with you, Chloe, and anybody else. But
I'd really support that approach. Norman, did you want to say something?
Thank you, Chair. As Hayden says, I only wanted to support his view that we need to press ahead, in my view, with this. And especially involving local authorities and groups in the allocation of the funds which we accrue from development. I know that in relation to Frampton Council, the parish council, they're very keen to be involved in the allocation of funds and to make it, if you like, more democratic, involving a wider group of people. So I'd be glad for it to come back earlier than it's listed here, and also with proposals to involve, as Hayden says, a local working group.
Thanks, Norman. Brendan, might it be possible, I'm conscious we've got a long agenda tonight, perhaps if we could have a meeting early in the new year, perhaps involving Norman and Hayden and me and Mark and anybody else, and we'll pick that up offline.
Absolutely. Happy to do that. Thank you, Chair. Yeah.
Okay. So let's start then with apologies. I'm aware that Councillor Dave Mossman is not here tonight. Is there anyone else who's... yes.
Councillor Sutton.
Sutton, right. Thank you, Hayden Sutton. And I think that's it, isn't it? Yeah. Okay. Lovely. Item two, declarations of interest. Yes, George.
Item nine on the agenda, although it's not pecuniary, I just thought I'd raise it. I am a governor of Archway School.
Thank you. Item three, the minutes of our last meeting, which was the 9th of September 2021. Does anyone have any objection to me signing those minutes? No, can't see any objections. So if you could raise your hands if you're in favour of me signing, that would be great. Thank you very much. Lovely. So let's move on to public questions then. We've got six public questions tonight. And the first two are from Eric Torrington, who is in attendance. Hi, Eric. I'd like to ask you to come up to the microphone to ask your first question. If you would like to read out your question, and then I'll read the response, and then you'll have an opportunity to ask a supplementary question. Oh, you come with props. Excellent.
This is mine.
And if we're unable to provide the answer to your supplementary question tonight, we'll respond to you outside of the committee.
Okay. Have I turned the microphone on? Do you want me to read the entire thing or just the question? Because this is that's the background to who I am.
I think probably just the question. Yes.
Okay. just to say briefly about myself, I'm a litter picker from Dursley. I have picked up 300,000 pieces of litter in your community over the last 2.5 years, probably more. Tomorrow I'll be on the A38 cleaning 6 of 13 lay-bys that I have voluntarily cleaned over the last 12 months. On Saturday morning I'll be cleaning a stretch of road between Nick's Timber Yard and the Ford Garage on Bristol Road in Gloucester, when I expect probably to pick up 1,000 items. I currently pick up 1,000 items of litter across my community in Dursley, principally around the Sainsbury supermarket, Red Knox School, Pulse Gym, interconnecting roads and lanes to those areas. So I had a lot of experience in litter picking, and from my perspective, I'm here to ask for your help in that current litter legislation simply does not work. And as councils, you have the ability to make it work. Two powers that you have under the legislation, and I'm particularly asking you to consider dealing with businesses to coach them, make them aware of their legal obligations, and to actually get them to comply with the litter legislation. So we're talking here about supermarkets, fast food outlets, none of whom comply with litter legislation in this country on a company-wide basis. You will have examples of good examples, and you'll have examples of very poor practice. So my question is, businesses need to be part of the litter solution and clean up in and around their premises, lead by example, and practice what they preach with anti-litter campaigns. This will act as a positive nudge to staff and customers. Therefore, will the council, when appropriate, initiate a program of engagement with major supermarkets and fast food outlets to start with in this community, making them aware of their legal obligations, instigating daily cleanup in and around their boundaries to standards called for in the codes of practice, and that will be litter grade B, and put in place measures to address littering hotspots resulting from their retail activities, typically within 100 metres of their outlets or otherwise agreed with the council. You have a window of opportunity because there is some momentum. I point you to Moto Services, who have 47 outlets across the country, motorway outlets, who currently clean up to their boundaries on a daily basis, and once a week on Litter Wednesdays, they go that bit further. It is work in progress, but they are making progress. And in September of this year, they had collected over 2,000 bags of litter from their premises and nearby. It makes a significant impact when businesses get involved. KFC, for example, have made a pledge that they're going to train 27,000 members of their staff to litter pick. They're already engaging with councils, and I understand they've engaged with this council. McDonald's, they have some of their staff, they're called Donald's Rangers. They will go out and litter pick in their communities, in and around their stores, and tackle litter hotspots. So you have a window of opportunity to engage with local businesses, particularly the supermarkets and the fast food outlets. They are becoming more aware of the environmental impact and community impact that their products and the packaging of their products has. Whilst these companies are not responsible for littering, they are responsible for the packaging, and they are certainly responsible for cleaning up in and around their premises under current legislation. So that's my first question.
Thank you, Eric. And I'm just going to read out our response to that. As the principal litter authority, Stroud District Council invest heavily in their street cleansing function, ensuring that the streets are swept, litter and dog bins are provided and emptied, and litter picking is undertaken as necessary. Since the COVID-19 pandemic started, levels of litter and fly tipping have increased. SDC have supported Ubico, our environmental services partner, by providing an additional interim resource to cope with demand. The budget setting paper being presented to committee tonight supports this and lays out the recommendation for an additional street cleansing crew to be added to the establishment on a permanent basis. Whilst SDC acknowledge the legislation at our disposal and concur that most litter items can probably be traced back to retail establishments, the blight of litter is particularly nuanced. Anecdotal evidence from our collection teams suggests that litter hotspots aren't necessarily driven by the proximity to retail, but can be in any location frequented regularly, either on foot or by vehicle. However, we're certainly keen for businesses to play their part. In 2022, SDC will be working on a new policy to formalise litter bin provision. This will provide an opportunity to engage with fast food and larger retail outlets as part of the preparatory work. I'm therefore happy to be able to agree to your request and will ensure that officers open dialogue with these businesses to try and bring about positive change. Importantly, SDC recognise the litter picking undertaken by residents and are thankful to all who partake and contribute to keeping our district as clean and tidy as possible. And I really would like to recognise the extraordinary contribution that you personally make, Eric, and I'm simultaneously very grateful but also depressed that it keeps on being necessary, but thank you.
You're welcome.
Would you like to ask a supplementary question?
The only supplementary question is an invitation if the person who wrote the response would like me to present my findings to them, because I believe there is a direct correlation between a retail outlet and where you will find litter, both in terms of footfall and also vehicle thrown litter. So I don't necessarily totally agree with the statement that there is no correlation with the locality and of a retail outlet, where is contrary, I believe there's a direct correlation. So the invitation is, if you would like me to tell you more about what I do and why I make that statement, or to the person who wrote the response, I'm making myself available to you.
Thank you. That's very kind, and I'm sure we'd welcome that. Did either of the officers here tonight want to respond?
Just the point that this is 1,400 items of soft plastic wrappers, have all been collected within close proximity of a school and Sainsbury's in Dursley. So there is a direct correlation, and I gave you, Chloe, a copy of a report that I have written presenting that.
Thank you, Chair. Hi, Eric, and yeah, I'd just like to echo what Chloe's already said, and thank you for the work that you undertake. I'd certainly be very happy to meet with you and talk through all the evidence that you have, and certainly would welcome your input into our work that's going to be undertaken next year. So very happy to exchange details maybe after this meeting, and we can get in contact. That'd be really useful for me.
Okay, you're welcome. I think it's important to get feedback from local litter pickers, as well as obviously business retail outlets.
Thank you. Eric, would you like to read out your second question?
I can. Under the powers of the Clean Neighbourhood and Environmental Act 2005, how many litter clearance notices, or as they call now, community protection notices, has the council as litter authority raised on businesses in the last 2 years?
Thank you, and I'll just read our response to that. None. However, STC do have powers to issue community protection notices, CPNs, directing businesses or individuals to clear litter from around their premises and or take steps to prevent future littering. CPNs would only be used if there was a persistent issue with sufficient warnings given in the first instance. Did you want to ask a supplementary in relation to that?
No, just to make an observation that this response is not uncommon. It's typical across many councils across the UK. It's almost a frustration to litter pickers, because you have the opportunity to make a difference. Okay, enforcement is the last straw, I guess. But unless we make the legislation work, then we're going to maintain the status quo, which is, you know, escalating litter levels in across our communities.
Thank you, Eric. Well, I'm sure we'll talk more about that when, yes, we meet. But thank you, and thanks, Mike.
Thank you.
Great. Questions 3, 4, and 5 are from Les Richards, who isn't in attendance tonight. Therefore, I'll read the question and responses in his absence. Bye, Eric. Thank you. Please, will the council consider a policy of businesses being able to sponsor litter bins and allowing their logos on the bins? SVCC was successful in Lidl agreeing to do this at Lower Dudbridge Lock after their railing works rendered the existing dog bin useless, but was refused as no such policy existed. SDC's response is as follows. The Environment Committee work programme for 2022 includes the creation of a new litter bin policy, which will be subject to approval from committee. This will be a comprehensive policy outlining how bin provision will be achieved and altered in our changing communities. The feasibility of a sponsorship scheme will be undertaken as part of this piece of work. Question 4. Both SVCC and SDC Canal volunteers have offered to the council to provide labour free of charge to install replacement or new bins along the canal towpath, already done at Bowbridge, to your approval. I've also requested replacement dog bin 1495, which is beyond repair, at Hilly Orchard Footbridge, and to replace the dog bin with a multi-purpose bin at Ham Mill Lock, both of which we would be happy to install. Please advise if the general offer of installation is acceptable and your thoughts on the two specific bins. SDC's answers as follows. As a general rule, officers have indicated that they are more than happy to accept the volunteers' offer to install new and replacement litter or dog bins along the canal towpath. Officers will make contact to arrange the installation of a new floor-mounted litter bin at Ham Mill Lock, alongside the removal of the dog bin at the same location. The dog bin removed will be used to replace the broken dog bin number 1495 at Hilly Orchard. Please note that there are supply issues with new bins and a current order won't be delivered until the new year. In the meantime, we'll persist with the existing provision as dog bin 1495 is unsightly but still serviceable. Question five. Please would officers approach Costa at Bonds Mill as their litter is blighting the towpath on both east and west, as well as being the reason the bin at Bonds Mill is often overflowing. And SDC's response, as per the response to the public question from Eric Torrington, officers will open dialogue with several businesses, including Costa, as part of preparatory work for the new litter bin policy referred to in question one. Right. Question six. The next public question is from Liz Childs, who is in attendance tonight. Hello, Liz. I'd like to invite you to the public question microphone to ask your question, where I'll then provide the response, and then you'll have an opportunity to ask a supplementary. Over to you. Oh, the question. In the interest of the district's future food and farm resilience, would... Oh, sorry. I meant to be letting you read that. Would you like to read that, Liz?
Am I on? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Described in the local plan is the policy of general restraint for planning in the open countryside. This policy may be too limiting for our rural farming landscape after a national 10% increase in local food retail market systems over recent years. In the interests of the district's future food and farming resilience, would it be best to follow the guidance of Professor Tim Lang, former director of the London Food Commission and currently of the City of London University's Centre for Food Policy, when he speaks of encouraging local councils to support the rebuilding of local food wholesale market system. This to return our market towns to being towns with markets, and thus a short route to direct sales for farmers. And secondly, enable a horticultural landscape adjacent to our towns and villages, thus adding more vocational employment, increased skills, diversity and prosperity for the small farms of the district. I ask that Stroud District Council agree to positively supporting planning considerations on behalf of local smallholders and the development of market gardens as the most sustainable thing to do for building a future food resilient district for the sake of our younger generations.
Thank you, Liz. And I'll just read the council's response. The council's local plan supports the diversification of farming businesses within rural areas for employment uses and supports the extension of rural businesses. The new emerging local plan provides even more positive support for rural tourism proposals, for proposals relating to biodiversity enhancement, carbon sequestration, and renewable forms of energy in the countryside. The emerging local plan also actively supports the provision of new community orchards and allotments. The Council has recently approved a draft economic development strategy, which identifies agriculture, agri-tech and rural diversification as a key sector to deliver our vision of a sustainable, inclusive and thriving economy for our businesses, communities and visitors. In the strategy, we highlight recent ideas for developing a circular economy in terms of food and farming, bringing positive impacts to the sector and local communities through improved access to the district's market offer. We will ensure that the emerging Gloucestershire food and farming strategy will be reflected in the final version of the strategy. We're currently welcoming views on the contents of the strategy and what actions need to be in the council's action plan to support our local economy. Views are welcomed by the 10th of February 2021. So thank you, Liz, and I know we share a common interest in this, and I really welcome your comments on the strategy as it comes forward, so we can catch up about that separately if that would be helpful. Thank you. Sorry, Liz, did you want to ask a supplementary? Yes, yeah, lovely. Please go ahead.
It's just that as planning is the tool that will enable farm diversification and therefore food security for us, it's going to be necessary for small holdings and market gardens when they require structures, such as entryways and fences and polytunnels, which often aren't approved when set against conservation interests. Would the council be active in favouring applications for regenerative small holdings as a matter of policy as part of the strategy? Thank you.
Thank you. Brendan, we haven't got anyone from planning here tonight, have we? So, Liz, if you're happy for me to do so, I'll take that question away and pick it up with our planning strategy manager. Thank you. Martin.
Is that a mistake, 2021?
Yes, well spotted. Right, so we move on now to item 8, the Ubico annual presentation, and we're very fortunate to have Beth Wharton with us tonight, Managing Director of Ubico, who's going to give us an update. Over to you, Beth.
Thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me. So I've come tonight to talk to you about Ubico's business plan for 22-23, which we do every year. It's part of the business plan governance for Ubico because approval of the business plan is a reserved matter for our shareholders. Now 8, Gloucester City joined Ubico as a shareholder formally about a fortnight ago. Approval of the business plan by our shareholders demonstrates control over Ubico. It's part of our what we call a TECL exemption, the type of company that we are, that we're wholly owned by you. And it demonstrates that you hold that control over the company. All of our shareholders have an equal vote. And it's actually a majority decision, but we always seek a consensus from all of our partners, and we come to do engagement to make sure that there's an opportunity for that conversation. The timeline for the business plan sign-off, between July and October each year, we develop proposed business plan themes. We come out to all of our partner councils between November and February to engage with you and seek any feedback. During February, then, we share a final draft with with the shareholder representatives and with the board for any final comments, obviously taking on board any comments that have come out of the engagement as well. And the formal shareholder approval then is sought after that final document has been circulated around March, April time. Last year, Ubico set out a new vision for the company, which is for the next 5 years. This current year is year one, 22-23 will be year two, which is recognised by our customers and employees as a quality provider of sustainable services for our local communities, delivering best value and reliability. And the strategy for delivering this vision is underpinned by four pillars. And the pillars are people, operational excellence, climate, and business development. And sort of the very high level objective of each pillar in terms of people, it's about the right talent in the right roles with the right skills. Operational excellence is deliver quality and value, maintain high standards. Business development is about building capability to deliver value to our partnerships. And climate is about minimizing our environmental impact and supporting our shareholders to meet their carbon neutral targets. For 22-23, the objectives that we're looking to include in the business plan, starting with the people pillar, there are three sub-pillars within the people pillar. The first one is around having agile leadership teams. So the first element that's mentioned on this slide is around building our HR function to meet the needs of Ubico's expanded operations. So we take on the services for Gloucester City from next April, and it's important that we have our HR function is built to support that. And so that's obviously a key element of the work that we'll do next year. We also want to design a leadership training and development programme to meet the needs of our senior leadership team. At the moment, we do training and development at more piecemeal, so we'd like that to be more of a programme. And we also need to review the terms and conditions for our staff and assess those against the market. We've seen particular resource pressures this year, as everybody has, but particularly around things like the drivers that we have to have a fair number of, and the national driver shortage has seen us have to put wages up slightly with the support of you, and thank you very much, to remain competitive in the marketplace. Obviously, that has caused a squeeze with the grades that are around that as well. So we need to just assess that and make sure that we are still relevant in the marketplace and attractive. On to the second point that ties in nicely with being an attractive local employer. We want to continue to improve our applicant process, and we're introducing an applicant tracker system shortly after into the new year, shortly after Christmas. We want to modernise the company induction process to help us enable digital delivery where that's possible. And we want to, obviously, we do a lot of support for mental health and wellbeing, and that's really important, particularly at the current time. So we'll be making sure that we continue with that good work. And finally, under people is excellence in training and development. And here we'll be looking to create a training and apprenticeship strategy for Ubico. So we don't actually have a strategy for that at the moment. You may remember that I talked to you last year about the newly formed in-house training centre that we have at Ubico that started in 2020. That's going really, really well. Really high quality training being delivered, and fantastic feedback and good engagement from the people taking the training. And so we want to make sure that we ensure the ongoing quality provision of that training. It's a real benefit to the company. And to tie it all together, we're going to pilot a learning management system so that we've got a system that is recording and centralises all of those records and things. In terms of our operational excellence, the first sort of sub-pillar here is around delivering quality. So this is about maintaining the standards that you expect to see, delivering high quality services that are reliable. So that means keeping our licenses that we have to have to operate. We'd like to maintain our ISO accreditation for our health and safety management system. We've got a fleet management system that's gone into all of our fleet workshops this year that we will embed in the next year. And then just referring again to Gloucester City, obviously, is our the new services that we'll be delivering from April. We'll be making sure that they're embedded throughout the year. In terms of adding value, again, this is about driving continuous improvement, making sure that we're continuing with our high safety standards, bringing innovation and making sure that we're efficient and effective. We've got a connected workforce project just starting, so we'll be mobilising that. That's essentially where we've got digital connection with the crews on the ground and throughout the day. And we've got a roadmap to launch that with each of our partners starting next year. And then also to continuing to explore cross-boundary opportunities and integration of work and collaboration across our partners where that's possible. In terms of finance, procurement and governance, we as a company are going to introduce an annual assurance review, very similar to the one that each of our partners does in their own councils. We want to make sure that we've got long-term strategic financial models in place for our partners. At the moment, it's been a year-on-year budget build. And we want to make sure that we're looking a bit further forward with that. We're piloting that this year, and we want to extend that out next year. And also continuing to explore options to help our partners meet the budget pressures that they're facing. In terms of marketing, a lot of the marketing sort of ties in with that. Recognition and knowing who Ubico are and all those sorts of things, so that we are an attractive local employer. And we'll be looking to improve our website and our social media footprint. We'll be undertaking a branding review. And also we want to make sure that we're promoting our successes in carbon reduction initiatives a bit more. We do quite a lot of carbon reduction initiatives, so we really want to make sure that everyone's aware of what we're doing. That brings us to our climate pillar. In our climate pillar, the first subheading is around our strategy. And it's interesting in the climate arena that there's a number of things that Ubico can do, but there are a number of things that we need shareholder engagement to do together, essentially. So I'll give you some examples. We have done lots of driver behaviour training to reduce carbon emissions with our Cotswolds teams. We've introduced a new tyre policy, which has saved a huge amount of carbon in terms of carbon not lost from the tyres as they're used on the road. And those are things that within Ubico's gift to drive forwards. However, there are some things that we need to work with you as our shareholders to do, such as if we were to go out and say we want to procure entirely, I don't know, renewable energy, there would be a cost implication potentially to that. So we need to make sure that that ties in with your strategies and with your financial profiles to make sure that obviously that is affordable and deliverable and something that our shareholders are supportive of, not something that we go ahead with without having consulted and engaged with you on. So a couple of more examples. So in the sort of Ubico arena, in the shareholder arena, working with you to evaluate the journey to net zero on our fleet. So we work very closely with you already, provide expertise on fleet specifications, but we realise that, again, isn't a year-on-year thing. There is a journey to evaluate there. So working closely together into the future on that still. And we'll also have a look at high-level options for strategic depot locations where appropriate so that we can inform shareholder partner decision-making if needed. And within Ubico, we'll create a baseline KPI framework so that we can underpin our progress reporting on our carbon journey. We want to expand that carbon reduction driver training I was just talking about as well across into some of our other partner councils where we've got the technology on the fleet to do that. And we have an accreditation for our to ISO standard for our environmental management system, and we'll be looking to retain that, have that for a number of years now. And last but not least, our business development pillar. There are two subheadings here. The first is about increased operational services for shareholders. So all of our shareholders take a slightly different profile of work from Ubico. So it's about looking at that and see if there's any opportunities to offer additional services for our current shareholders. And we'll also do a piece of work to look at the feasibility of Ubico being involved more in some more of the further down the line recyclate reprocessing than we currently look at, and also the feasibility of whether there's any development we could do in our facilities management arena, which at the moment is quite small. And then lastly, we've got what I've called Future Ubico, so sort of looking further forwards beyond the five-year vision. So our board have reached a consensus that we need to consolidate our business foundations within this five-year vision. But in that time, we will come to you to understand and agree principles with you about what the future might look like, both in terms of things like geography, your risk appetite, alignment. We have 8 partners, so alignment is obviously something that's really sort of integral to this. And then that will feed then into us looking at what sort of vehicle we might be able to use should there be an appetite to do any future growth to do that best for our partners in obviously after that first five-year vision has been completed and then beyond that. So just to sort of summarise the next steps, I've called this socialise, finalise, deliver. So out at the moment, obviously talking to all of our partners and in continuing that engagement until February. Then finalising, as I said earlier on, it's that board endorsement and then shareholder final sign-off around March, April time. And then obviously delivery of the vision then of the business plan in 22-23. That concludes all of my slides. Thank you.
Thank you, Beth. That was really interesting. George, looks like you've got a question.
Thank you. That was interesting. I really enjoyed it. I've got a few questions, but I'll go with mine. I'll wait my turn to come around again. I've been reading a lot recently about conversion of current refuse trucks into electric ones. So splitting this up, have you considered doing that? If you have, what progress is being made? Because, I mean, a simple reading is sort of saying it saves about 23K a year once done. And I just wondered if that's being considered and what progress is being made there.
So we work closely with the officers because the fleet is owned by the council, not by Ubico at the moment. So you are the ones who are specifying and procuring that. So we work very much with you to make sure that we're in line with your the finances that you've got, the capital spending that you've got available for that. We have trialled a vehicle that was converted from an old diesel vehicle into an electric vehicle. I don't think it was an unsatisfactory experience at all. I think what you've got to factor in is the difference in price between that one and the new one, and whether there is a life cycle analysis element that you want to do to look at whether which one is the best option. But we would work with officers to make sure that all of that work was done before we take any decision like that. So it's not a yes or a no, if you see what I mean. It's about the best option at the time for whatever it is that it needs replacing at that moment.
Yeah. Yes, Councillor Tipper.
Yes, thank you, Chair. My question is that how many councils do you work with? Is it just local councils or?
Yeah.
So is the way you practice how you do your work, is it common to every one of those councils, or is there a council that does things better than anyone else? So that's leading to my question.
Yep.
If that's the case, do you practice benchmarking? In other words, you bring the better practice to the to the other councils. Yep. That's what I'm trying to say.
Yep.
There is one other question, but would you care? And thank you, by the way, for a wonderful presentation.
No problem.
Very,
thank you.
Very businesslike. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So we provide services for 8 councils. So it's all of the district councils in Gloucestershire and the county council and West Oxfordshire District Council. There are shareholders. We don't provide services for Gloucester until next April. You all select a slightly different set of services. There are a number of you who have all your waste and recycling sort of delivered by us. And within that, there's lots of things that are different. So each of you specifies your recycling service particularly is very different across the board. And it can be, we still do a lot of curbside sort, and then we go right up to, we do a fully commingled service for one of our councils. So a huge variety in the recycling. The food waste, the garden waste, and the refuse collections tend to be much more similar. You all have a much more similar routine of collection, type of receptacle, frequency, all those sorts of things. So those in those areas, it's much more synergistic. That's, I haven't made that word up, than it is across the recycling. The recycling is much more about local choice still.
Okay.
Yeah.
A second question then. Some of the containers that are involved. Some of them are not, I'll be honest with you, fit for purpose. The classic example is the cardboard box. I had a new one when I moved into my house, and frankly, I happened to end up with a spare one somehow. And I've got through both those in a few years where they cracked. They pinch people's hands. I happen to put away in the morning about 6 neighbours' stuff, and they're all the same. It's quite common. And the actual brown container, I've seen them splitting down the sink. So my argument is that the the material that they're made from isn't the right material. It's not a flexible material. It's a it seems to be like a cheap version of it. And what are we going to do about that?
I'm afraid it's where I'm going to have to pass back to your officers, because they're the ones who buy the receptacles. We don't buy them. The councils still buy them. So
asking you, anybody listening, deal with it.
Yeah, no, absolutely no problem at all. It's one, the officers are listening, so yeah.
It might be that, Mike Towson, would you like to say a few words?
Yeah. Thanks for the question, Brian. And I think you've got a sound point there. With regards to the brown containers for the garden waste, we did have a faulty batch, and we are aware of a number of bins splitting down the side. We're obviously replacing those bins free of charge, so anyone that's impacted, any residents, we'll get that bin swapped out. We did come to an arrangement with the manufacturer so that we weren't impacted financially, although, the damage is already done by the time that we've got faulty bins, so that's not an ideal situation. We have changed our supplier of recycling box. I'm still getting multiple complaints about breakages, so it's something that we'll continue to analyse. But we are procuring from leading manufacturers in the UK, if there's a higher specification that we can get, that's certainly something that we can investigate. It's something that we've changed within the last 12 months, 12, 18 months. Time flies, isn't it? Really, really keen to get the best quality product that we can out on the streets.
So I can presume from that that you won't be making the same mistake again. In other words, you'll be looking at the materials that they're made from to create sustainability, and frankly, to make it cheaper at the end of the day for the ratepayer.
Yeah, and that's a really good point. Sometimes you get what you pay for, and cost isn't always king. And, you know, paying that little bit extra, you know, does pay for a longer term product. So, yeah, absolutely.
Thank you. Thanks, Mike. Any other? I think I saw your hand up, Tricia. Did I?
Tried not to. Was it subconscious? yeah, my interest is in the extra recycling items. I will be discussing this with the officers before I go to Ubico, but it's similar to the best practice. I know that Cheltenham, for instance, collect those coffee pods, and it's all these niche things, and I'm aware we've got difficulties with our vehicles. Whether it's electricals or textiles, there's always a reason why the vehicle's not big enough or whatever. So it's just wanting to get the best practice and possibly even do a collaborative piece where perhaps across the different councils, as these new specialist options become available, that we can all work together to fund it as effectively and sustainably as possible.
Yeah, absolutely. We can work with officers on that.
Thank you.
Just very briefly on that, and I have discussed with the chair previously that you know, we are limited by the space on the vehicle that we have. We are looking with our fleet replacement to introduce cages to the sides of the vehicle, and then we can look at what the best recycler, the best additional recycler to collect would be, whether that be textiles, small wheel. So yeah, thank you, good question.
Thank you, George. You had another one.
I just wanted a little bit, you mentioned a branding review, and I just wondered, I mean, my personal thoughts are really that this isn't necessarily the right climate in which to do it, but I just wanted a bit more info, if you could provide.
It actually probably sounds a slightly grander, it's more of an internal, ensuring that we are standard in the sort of branding that we're using for Ubico. So, a little bit different, perhaps, probably sounds very commercial, doesn't it, actually? It's more of an internal activity. No, the good feedback. Thank you. I'll make that clear with other partners.
Martin.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you for your presentation, Peg. How much of a problem with drivers are you having of getting them and keeping them, and what are you doing about it?
So it's much better than it was. It's not an easy situation, but that's not just us, that's across the board. It was particularly difficult, I would say, in July time. So pretty much when it hit the press was the time that you won't be surprised to hear, was the time we were struggling. We've managed to keep all the services on the road. We've done so really patching over with things like using charge hands who've got HGV licenses and supervisors who've got HGV licenses. It has been on the goodwill of our wonderful staff that we've kept things on the road, really. It's been, you've probably seen a little bit of an impact potentially in terms of missed bins or in terms of not putting the boxes back quite as tidily, because we've had quite a lot of disruption in terms of staff. Also trying to maintain them in a bubble so that we don't get coronavirus issues as well. So there's been a huge amount to juggle this year. It's been a very difficult year. In August, we developed a medium-term strategy for helping with the driver shortage and making sure that Ubico got drivers when we needed drivers, and that we were competitive in the marketplace, that we were making sure we were advertising in the right places, advertising the right things, selling ourselves for the things that we really are strong for our employees. So we did a big review of what our adverts looked like, how we were advertising the money, the hourly rate rather than the salary, those sorts of things that are important. The fact, for example, that the vast majority of our work is in the week and not at the weekend, unless it's been a bank holiday week or something exceptional, and you know those are coming. You're not driving all the way to Scotland and back, that sort of thing. So we did a big review of how we're advertising. And we also, our hourly rate for the drivers went up from the 1st of September, so we increased, we have a market supplement on it. And all of those things combined, and others, I'm sure if the ops director was here, he'd be telling you more than that, has activity has happened and has helped to steady the ship. So our sort of attrition rates have dropped. So where drivers were being attracted away locally, that seems to have stopped, and we haven't had nearly as much of that. And so that's a big win for us. They're already trained, they're already in, they already know the company and the districts. We want our drivers, who are excellent drivers, to stay. We don't want them to be attracted away. So that's our sort of primary aim. Secondary then is attracting the right candidates as well. So we've developed that strategy now, and it does seem, touch wood, but in the first instance, it seems to have helped initially. So it's a difficult situation. Yeah.
Are you still short?
We are coping. So the other thing that we had historically, we had a pool of staff. So instead of getting agency staff in all the time, we'd built up a pool of trained staff who were then competent and ready to go on any of our services. And that pool has been eroded. So that's where we've seen the problem. So we don't have the backup that we used to have potentially, because that pool is now essentially frontline. And there aren't as many agency staff. They're just not available, particularly agency drivers. So we're coping. But it's not just for us, but it is a situation that it's all right at the moment, but it's not, there's just a national shortage.
Thank you. I've got one more question from Councillor Tipper.
Some years ago, I did an inquiry at county level with regard to the fire service, and part of the inquiry led to us realising about sick pay and that sort of thing when a fireman couldn't or was incapable of doing the job, to the level they were trained. I want you to realise that I've got the employee in your industry in mind, and in particular. I'm thinking about the people that follow the vehicles around, and they're running, or walking very, very fast. So my question is, when they get to a point where they can keep up, how do we look after them in terms of going forward? I mean, are they left to sort of leave and do something else, or? Do we look after an employee that has done that, say, for 15 or 20 years? And, I would like quite a clear and cut statement as to how we look after the employee, please.
Okay, so a large number of employees, if they find that they're getting to that point and they need something less physical, will apply for jobs on our other services that perhaps aren't so physically strenuous. So we get a lot of people with a very long length of service who don't leave the company. Others might choose to go and do something different. That's their choice. So you see a mixture, really. But we don't essentially put people out to pasture, if you see what I mean, at a fixed age or anything like that. We've got some staff who still do that job, for a very long time and are very fit and able to do it, I think, really, because they've always done it. And so it doesn't seem to be, I'm aware of, a particular problem that we have.
With respect, there are only so many soft, what I call soft jobs. There's only so, like the driver in the cab or whatever else.
Yeah.
And all I'm trying to say is that there's going to be a pressure point, as to how that employee can continue to be useful and bearing in mind the service he's given them, or that she has given, as there are some ladies. In other words, I want to know that I would like to think they're being looked after.
I would like to counter that I don't think they're not being looked after. They have a choice to apply for something if there is something else. Equally, we have to have that balance, don't we, about being too benevolent and those sorts of things and having an affordable service. But I have to say, I haven't seen that this is a problem within Ubico where we've got lots of people who are suddenly saying, I can't work anymore, I'm out of work. It hasn't come to the fore, to my mind.
Thank you. Yes, Hayden.
Thanks, Chair. This is a bit parochial because obviously you're looking at it from a higher level. You mentioned strategic sites, and obviously in Stroud we've got Gossington, but I'm sure in this paper somewhere I saw investment in Frampton. I might be wrong, but firstly, could you or one of the officers tell me about what plans they have for the Gossington depot? And secondly, am I mistaken in reading Frampton in here somewhere? Have we still got any business there? Or you've got any business there? Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Hayden. Funnily enough, I was having a scan through the paperwork for this evening earlier, and I spotted that very same thing. And it's in the 5-year prospective seal projects where they've been given interest. That's where the list is, and I believe that's probably in relation to potential works at Gossington rather than at Frampton. So I believe, and I don't want to put you on the spot, Krista, but Krista might be able to say more, but I believe that's just a, a typo rather than there being a specific project. I did think the same thing, to be perfectly honest.
We won't put you on the spot, Krista. perhaps, Krista, you might be able to look at it after the meeting and come back to Hayden. But
we're talking about the appendix future project areas.
Yes, Appendix B.
Yeah, they are project areas that we were made aware of from the very beginning of the scheme. Are we talking about the potential depot at Frampton? Yeah. So that might just be a historic miscommunication, because that was something that Mike and his team put on the list and haven't told me to take off.
Yeah. So that should be depot expansion at Gossington rather than anything in relation to Frampton.
Okay. I'll get that amended.
Thank you. Right, unless there are any more, I think we should probably move on. But thank you very much, Beth, for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you
very much.
It was a really helpful session. So we're going to move now to item 6, which is the budget monitoring report for the second quarter of 21-22. And we've got Adele Rudkin, our accountant, here tonight, who's going to present that report. Thanks, Adele.
Thank you, Chair. So this is the first of the two reports that I've got to present to you tonight. And this is the quarter two report following on from the quarter one report that I presented to you back in September. Hopefully members will have had an opportunity to read through the report prior to the meeting. So I'll just do a brief overview of what's in there. The decision box basically is to note the outturn forecast for the general fund revenue budget and the capital programme for this committee. If we start with a summary, it gives you an outline of what your underspend is for this committee and some various narrative around that. We lead into item 3, which is the revenue budget position, which again outlines the position for the budget, and it also says, referring to some tables that will give you some more information within the report. So the first key table is table 1, and that gives you a high level breakdown of the services within this committee regarding the forecast outturn, which is always the forecast outturn that they are predicting at year end. And also any pressures, there's a table we added on last time for any pressures that were reported through to SNR due to COVID-19. Below the table, you'll see narrative applicable to those areas where it's deemed narrative is needed. So we've got areas like development control, land charges, and the waste and recycling area. Item 4 is your COVID pressures, and we've only got one item to report forecasting on this at the moment, which is a much bigger improvement than what you had in quarter 1. Item 5 is the capital programme, again for this committee for 21-22, giving you the forecast outturn and the variance and the narrative below it according to those schemes. And that goes on over the page. And then the very last item is the table, which is in essence a more of a breakdown of your table 1, again breaking those areas down into their significant parts. And that's it. So I'm happy to take any questions on that first paper.
Any questions for Adele? Nope. Oh, yes, Norman.
Thank you. It's just a question on the appendix, paragraph 3.8, which is the Ubico multi-service contract, and it refers to the theft of an amount of fuel from Gossington. I just wondered if you could elaborate on that a little.
Sorry, could I refer you to Mike Tyson behind you, because you have a little bit more detail than I will.
Yeah, thank you, Adele, and thanks for the question, Norman. Yeah, unfortunately, we have experienced the theft from Gossington, so the diesel is held in a tank on site, and unfortunately, you know, we had a tanker pull up in the lay-by outside Gossington, and run a hose to all the way to the diesel tank, which is at the back of the depot, and pumped out a considerable amount of diesel. We've since improved security measures, introduced better CCTV, increased the fence line, and touch wood, we're in a better position. But yeah, it was a substantial theft.
Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Martin.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Very quick one, Adele. The COVID pressure on development on DC, yeah. That's because of reduced revenues from applications, is it?
That's staffing, increased
staffing. Oh, right. To cover it, I think she's outlined on that. Back into quarter one, she was, Geraldine, I should say, was forecasting quite a loss on income, but that's picked up, and you know, fortunately, it's not as bad as what. And obviously, at quarter one, we didn't know where we were, but we've given a much more positive view now, and she's actually taken that that will have no negative impact on income this year.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. I know it feels really rude to have your back to someone, but the people at home can't hear you if you face away from the microphone. Okay, if we've not got any more questions, I'll read the decision. The committee resolves to note the outturn forecast for the general fund revenue budget for the capital programme for this committee. Do we have a proposer for that? Thank you, Norman. And a seconder? Thank you, George. Would you like to speak, George, now or later? No? Okay. So I'll open it up to debate then. Tumbleweed. It's not that your report wasn't very interesting, Adele. Okay. And George, did you, Norman or George, did you want to make any comments?
Only to record our thanks to our accountant and our financial staff for a very detailed report.
Thank you very much, Norman. In that case, we'll go to the vote. So if you'd like to raise your hand in favour, please. That looks like everybody, Ashley. Thank you very much. Okay, so we'll move on to item 7 then, which is environment revenue estimates revised for 21-22 and original for 22-23, and it's Adele again.
Thank you, Chair. So this is the second report of the evening, This report is giving you an update of any changes, obviously, to the budget for this financial year, but considerably more importantly, the estimates for 22-23. The report should follow the same format again as we try to follow the same format as we do sort of with budget monitoring, and hopefully anybody that was able to attend the budget setting overview sessions that I ran. The content in the layout will follow that, and hopefully it will be a little bit more familiar to you. There is quite a few items in the decision box, but in essence, it's to present to you the revised revenue budget for 21-22 and the 22-23 original budget. List of fees and charges, which were in Appendix B, and there's a couple of recommendations to go forward to strategy resources regarding the new waste and recycling rounds and a new street cleaning crew, which was touched upon earlier, and also on the capital budget, there's the replacement of the 3 diesel powered vehicles with electrical equivalents, again, which was talked about earlier with Beth's, where they're looking at improving those things. So if I go into the report, again, we start with a background, which gives you an overview of where we've come from
how we've reached this budget. It started with the budget strategy, and then we've gone through, met with budget holders to identify areas where budget has changed or budget's needed, and it's also built into the MTFP. The summary gives you an overview of what the budget is, the revised and the updated budget. And then if we go straight into table one, this hopefully will look familiar to you. Column one is a 21-22 revised estimates, and 22-23 is the original estimates. And those budgets were changed by things like pay increases, fees and charges growth, contract increases, etc. So below those is some narrative according to what those items are, and giving you a little bit more detail around it. The key area is on number four, I suppose, is the proposed budget adjustments. Well, actually, we'll lead on to those in a minute. Under 3.5 is the contract increases, which a lot of that obviously is concerned with the Ubico. And we've included a Ubico table with the changes to the budget, which gives you an idea of where those changes in the budget have changed from the budget setting protests that we agreed that we've set up with Ubico. And you'll notice you'll see the new rounds are set in there, and also the market supplement that Beth touched on earlier. Item four is a table showing you your budget pressures and savings that have been presented to this committee. So there's a number of items there in the pressures, climate change, again, the multi-service contract. Although those items, the first two items there are for receptacles, there's the Ubico, there's some development control, and there are a few savings, which is always good news. Development control, supplementary income expected, some more garden waste income, and additional recycling. Below the table, you will see narrative applicable to any of those areas. So if you want any extra detail, that narrative is there for you to peruse. And also the savings. Item five is the capital programme. So again, this is showing the capital projects for this committee. Item D in the decision box on the front of the page, which is to do with the multi-service contract vehicles. Again, it's replacing these vehicles with electric rather than diesel. And then there's further narrative underneath according to each of those schemes and about where they are in the programme at that time. And then finally, we have Appendix A. Again, you should recognise that the format of the table, because it's more of a breakdown of an original services and table within this committee. And I touched on first that there was the fees and charges in B. So in essence, that's just a brief overview of the paper. Happy to take any questions if there are any. Thank you.
Thanks, Adele. I'd just like to thank you for the information evening that you ran as well. I think that made a big difference to new members like me and for our ability to understand the figures. So, Councillor Tippett, did I see your hand?
Thank you, Chair. I don't know if there are relevant questions to this person, but and probably they won't be able to give me an answer. But over the years, I've asked very similar questions about it. And I'm talking about fly tipping. How much does it cost the Stroud District Council to collect fly tipping? You know done. What I would also like to know if there's any kind of analysis of what has been tipped. How much of it is the big items? And thirdly, how much revenue is made from the big item collection in terms of people phoning in to get items collected. Are you able to answer those questions now, or would you like time to work it out? And what I would also like to know is that is Stroud District Council capable of having the cost centres to answer those questions? And if they haven't, would they create them so that they can answer that question, please?
Thank you, Brian. Can I hand over to Mike Towson, because they are running the scheme. We might be able to give you a bit more detail, but obviously come back to you if we need to follow up with any further on your questions this evening. Is that okay?
Could do something better or continue as we are, that type of thing. I've never had over 2007, in 14 years I've been on the Environment Committee, I've asked the question many times, and frankly, it's never been minuted that I've asked the question.
Okay, I'll hand you over to Mike.
Okay, yeah, thank you, Brian. In terms of the bulky collections, that service does cover its own costs. So essentially for the £25 booking and the crew that we send out, those costs from Ubico are broken down to service level. So we know what the costs are relating to that bulky collections scheme, and we know the revenue that we get to that. And that's it's essentially a cost neutral service, and I think there's an additional £10,000 been put in the revenue for next year in terms of the budget, because there's an increased demand for that service. So that covers off that one, hopefully. In terms of fly tipping, I think there was a members information bulletin, and I'll dig it out and send you on the details. I don't recall exactly when that was, but there was quite a bit of information with regards to fly tipping in that bulletin. I'll dig it out for you. But it is very awkward to absolutely comprehend how much it's costing SDC to collect the fly tipping. We've got streets crews that won't just go out and collect fly tipping. They'll be undertaking other duties and will collect fly tipping. So it's very, very hard for us to understand exactly what the costs are. But like I say, hopefully if I can find that members information bulletin, I will send you the link, and that will provide you with some more detail.
If I could come back, yeah. I guess my interest is that if we're charging for the big items and within the fly tipping, there are a lot of big items, are we sort of shooting ourselves in the foot by charging the money? And then but it's costing us to go out and collect it because we're charging them in the first place.
Yeah, I see what you're trying to say there. When we introduced the charge for bulky items, there wasn't a particular uplift in fly tipping. What COVID-19 has seen a really dramatic uplift, I'm still at a loss as to why that is. But that's the reflection, unfortunately. So, I don't think there's a correlation with cost and fly tipping, but there certainly is with COVID for whatever reason.
Through the chair, why I'm asking the question is I do notice the comments on Facebook, and once you get one comment, it flourishes, in terms of, oh, yes, they charged me this, that and the other. All I'm trying to say is that if we can analyse it, then we might be able to do get a better balance as to what to do going forward. And that's why I keep asking the question. Thank you.
We won't forget to minute it this time, Brian. Thank you very much, Mike. Any more questions for Adele? Nope. Okay, in that case, I'm going to read out the decision. The committee recommends the Strategy and Resources Committee A, the revised Environment Committee budget for 21-22 and original 22-23 revenue budget are approved. B, the fees and charges list as shown at Appendix B is approved. C, the inclusion of 176,000 within the Ubico contract for new waste and recycling rounds, an additional 52,000 for the provision of a new street cleaning crew. And D, in addition to the 22-23 capital budget of 106,000, funded through additional budgeted income to meet the extra cost of replacing three diesel-powered vehicles with electric equivalents in line with Council Plan Objective 6.3. Do we have a proposer for that? Thank you, Robin. And a seconder? Martin, thank you. Martin, did you want to speak now? Nope. Okay. In which case, I'll open it up to debate. No? Okay. Everybody just wants to get home. okay, lovely. Well, Robin or Martin, did either of you want to say anything before we go to the vote?
Just to know, thanks for a detailed and comprehensive report. I'll support for it.
Thank you very much.
Likewise. Thank you, Adele.
Thank you. In that case, could I have votes for, if you could raise your hand if you're in favour? Great. I think that's everybody. In which case, thank you very much. We will move on then to item 8, which is the council plan and performance indicators relevant to this committee. And I'm going to hand over to Brendan Clear here, Strategic Director of Place, to present this report.
Thank you, Chair. And good evening, councillors. Couple of points just by way of introduction to this report then. As you'll know, the council plan was adopted by full council back in October. And since then, a lot of work's gone into creating performance indicators to measure the success or not of the plan as we roll forward. I'd particularly like to thank all councillors of this committee and across the council, actually, as well as colleagues and officers in taking the time to work up performance indicators and input into the development of those. And I know that we had a session of Environment Committee chaired by yourself, Chloe, on as an informal session on what those KPIs could look like. The performance management framework of this plan is going to follow a familiar pattern, really, of plan, do, review, and revise. And I'd emphasise the revise bit of that, because I think one of the key points I'd like to make in commending this report to you this evening is that it's not set in stone. And as things go forward, I'm sure in the spirit of continuous improvement and performance management, we'll find better performance indicators, better ways of measuring the plan as we roll forward. And the process has got scope and flexibility to incorporate that as we move forward. So I'd emphasise that sort of as a health warning, I suppose, in commending the plan to you and these PIs that it's not set in stone. And I think that's really important. As well, just to remind or to emphasise that the policy and governance team who've done some really sterling work in not just in the council plan, but in the PIs as well, ran a session on the members on the 1st of December on the performance management and framework and project management. It was well received by those attending, but there will be further opportunities. There'll be further sessions on that and more detailed and specific training for those members involved in performance monitoring on this committee and also the other committees. So I would like to pause there, take any questions, and just commend the report to you. Thank you. Thank you, Chair.
Thanks very much, Brendan. Any questions for Brendan? Yes, Hayden.
Thanks, Chair, and thanks, Brendan, for that. Myself and Martin, I know, were on the call the other day, but freezing to death here when the heating wasn't working, but we had to attend a DCC meeting, so we had to leave quite early. So one of the questions I wanted to ask on measure EC6, renewable energy, it talks about increasing the proportion of energy generated by renewable sources in the district and work on decarbonising existing networks. Do you do anything to measure the net gain And the reason I ask is because there are questions that have been asked. There are a lot of potential proposed solar developments. And I am conscious, and those that have spoken to me are conscious, about the land that is then taken out of agricultural production. That production will need to be made up from elsewhere. And the general concern is that it's made up by growing it elsewhere in the world, putting on a ship and bringing it over here. So I just wonder if there's any calculation of net gain of these things. Now, this might be beyond the scope of this council. We're quite small, you know, and this might be a government, if they ever get their act together, a government thing that they need to do a proper survey of it. But do you see what I mean? There, it's great covering things in solar panels, but that agricultural land that is taken out of production, if indeed that's where they're placed, I just wonder how we incorporate that into any measure we take to make sure that we're genuinely getting a benefit from this, not just offshoring our carbon, to be honest.
Chair, if I can, I mean, I think that's a really good question. I don't have a definitive answer this evening, but it would be really good if I could take that one away, and we could note it, and build it into the process going forward. But I think I'll need to take that one away, Hayden, if that's okay with you. Thank you.
It would be good to get the 2030 officer's view on that, wouldn't it? And I know, yes, we've got a fuller session in March when the 2030 sort of programme is coming back, and there's probably a couple of similar objectives that we could ask similar questions on, actually, so perhaps we could dig into it then. Yes, Brian.
Well, the question from Hayden is sort of lines up with the presentation or the question from the lady earlier on about about agricultural land, and from a county point of view, I would like to think that any land used by the solar farms, for instance, it isn't useful for anything else other than in the classic example, say Cambridge, where the land floods underneath the solar panels. So in other words, the land isn't arguably isn't much good for anything else. I think that's what Aidan's trying to say, or has said, and insult intended. But all I'm trying to say is that these policies have all started, got to start integrating, and when we're asked to doing one thing, we're doing another, and making sure that everything's functional.
Thank you. Yes, agreed. Anybody else? Yes, Martin, you're first. Oh, sorry.
Thank you, Chair and Brendan. I have four specific things. Maybe I should have raised them at the previous meeting. Maybe I did. I don't know. I'll just quickly, and I'll start with the last one because it overlaps with Hayden's, and this may sound a bit nitpicking on 6.1, where a measure is said to be achieve 36% of energy generated from renewable sources. That sounds like a goal rather than a measure. I'm wondering if there should be something progressive year by year on that. Not sure. It sounds like a goal more than a measure. I go back through the three others I have. Back up to 4.1. What did I want to say about this? I'm sorry. Number of schemes, how we measure success, TNF. All right, sorry, I'm not sure what I wanted to say about that one. Up to 2.1, please. I wondered if under the local nature recovery strategy, whether there could be something about number of partnerships or projects, as in 2.2.
I think that came up in the meeting, actually, so that probably should be in there already. Mm-hmm. And there was also the mention of... I know it's not a very satisfactory goal, but just having the strategy in place was also going to be a measure. I think I might go back to my notes of that meeting and just check, because I think there's a couple of things that aren't in there yet that we did agree on.
And then the other one is back up at 1.5. Where the measure seems to be just money spent, pounds used to leverage. And I wondered if there could be something more in the way of a measure of carbon reduction or of biodiversity gain, which are the substantive things there. So I'm not sure, not just the money we threw at it, but what's been achieved with the money.
Again, that was another one we discussed in some detail. Mm-hmm. And I think we got to the point where we just left it with the money as a very crude measure, with a view to revisiting it when we, you know, got a bit more idea of what the kind of projects might look like, to come up with a better measure. But Trish, do you remember where we got to with this? Well, there were a number of them where we acknowledged the fact that the current measure is not satisfactory, but until we know what kind of projects come along, we can't envisage quite what the measure will be.
We definitely agreed that there needs to be some better measure, because purely number of pounds, that could just be a massive successful grant. It's not measuring the carbon saving and the other benefits. And also, what you apply for is within your control. What you get is outside your control. So we might apply for hundreds, but because of the massive pressures on the budget, we might not get that. So that there's got to be some measure of number of projects in here. I hoped we were going to have a sort of draft of numbers of projects as well as pounds, and also the application effort that we put in to make sure we're doing all we can to monitor both sides of that equation. And yeah, I like you, was hoping those comments would be in here, but they're not yet. So something, perhaps a draft bullet point saying we need to measure more than just the pounds, and we'll revisit that, would be helpful.
Yes. Yeah. Brenda.
Something I forgot to mention, thank you, Chair. Something I forgot to mention in my intro was on performance monitoring. You'll know as a committee that we get a performance monitoring report at every meeting, and that will now be superseded. The one we have been getting will be superseded by a report that looks at all of these objectives, the objectives in the round, and not just the KPIs as well. So I think that broader narrative will help. But we do need to improve. As I said in my intro, we will be revising and improving these PIs. And making them a bit more rich than they are at the moment in some respects. I appreciate the money side of it is a bit of a blunt instrument, and we could be measuring things more sharply around things like biodiversity net gain and such like. So we will be looking to do just that. Thank you.
I think, some things clearly lend themselves better than others, don't they, to a precise metric, and sometimes it will be about the narrative that comes with it. But I did say to Brendan that I think the first meeting where we get this fuller, richer report coming back with the metrics and the text, that will be a good opportunity for us to talk as a group about how, you know, satisfied we are with that, and then over time to modify it as we see fit. But Norman.
Thanks, Brendan, for the report. I wanted to talk about, again, EC6, the renewable energy aspiration that we've got to increase renewable generation and to achieve 36% of energy generated from renewable sources. I just wanted you and your team to be aware of the problems that we've got with the AONB board, the Cotswold National Landscape Board, because their planning officer has chosen to object to our plans, about our revised plan to the planning inspectors, and to use flagrant language that, quotes, is not consonant with the law, which is nonsense, but nevertheless, that's a submission that he's made. And that's because the Cotswold National Landscape Board have rested on the original legislation that set them up, now the Crow Act 2000, which says that the primary duty of the AONB, as it was then called, was to preserve and enhance the beauty of the AONB. And of course, half of our land in the district is within the AONB. Now, I've been arguing over the last couple of years for the AONB board to recognise that it's not only got that duty, but it also has another statutory duty, which is to support the social and economic vitality of local communities. and where there's strong support by local communities for renewable energy, then the AONB should be giving support to that. But there's a significant group within the AONB, and I include the chief executive and the planning officer in that, who want to oppose that recognition by not supporting turbines which are over 25 meters in height, or solar arrays of larger than 1 hectare, whereas we've been trying to argue for larger turbines of up to 60 meters in height and larger areas for solar arrays, not automatically, but to allow applications in principle, which are then considered on their merits. So I'll just really want you and your officers to be aware of the problems that we have. Mark Russell is already aware. I think it will come to a head at their AGM next February or March. But any support that we can give to adopting a more acceptable approach would be great.
Thank you, Norman. I think Mark Russell, our head of planning strategy and economic development, isn't here tonight, but I know that as the council has approved our draft local plan, submitted that now to government for inspection, for examination in public, and that is anticipated to take place next spring. We're waiting on the sort of detailed timetable, but you know, we've supported that local plan as a council, and the policies in it around renewable energy, and we'll be defending it robustly in that process. And so, as you say, that the Cotswold National Landscape have objected to that, and it'll be the inspector that hears that and comes to a view, but we'll be defending it strongly as a council, I can assure you of that.
Thank you. Robin, did you have a question?
No.
Okay. Tricia.
Just like to thank the officers for turning around all those comments that we made in one of the earlier meetings about this. Most of them have been incorporated, but there's still a few ranging from typos through to queries that haven't been answered. Is it appropriate to go through those now? I've already sent them to the lead, Catherine. But it's things like there's a typo in that says spring 2021 when it should be 22.
Thank you. I mean, if you could just let me have those as well, that would be great. If you could send those through.
They don't need to be minuted here because I don't want to recommend them as they are now, because there's still some fundamental errors, very minor, but need to go through.
Yes.
So, where's the ambition that we keep talking about that needs to be a little bit?
Absolutely. Although we are recommending this tonight, it's not on the basis that this is final by any means, because clearly it's going to be a shifting landscape. But we've also got a bit of time till strategy and resources in January, plenty of opportunity to feed in those specific comments. So thank you. Anybody else? No? In that case, I'll read out the decision. The committee resolves to A, agree on the performance indicators that are relevant to this committee, and the committee recommends to strategy and resources that A, these performance indicators are incorporated in the council plan and updated and monitored according to the council's performance management framework. Do we have a proposer for that? Natalie, have you got your hand up? Yes, thank you. And the seconder? Thank you, Hayden. Hayden, would you like to speak?
No, thank you for the report. And I'm pleased that this is an evolving thing that will be subject to change as we go forward. But otherwise, I think it's a step forward. Thank you.
Thank you very much. In that case, I will open it up to debate if anyone has any additional comments they'd like to make. George.
It is really totally minor, but I just feel that if I don't say it, I'll be kicking myself. There are a number of points where the success is a percent of increase in X, Y, and Z. It would be nice because, I mean, if 1% is a measure of success and we've only done 1%, I don't think that's necessarily successful. It's been an increase. That's great. but it's just not quite enough. I just feel that in places, a tinker in those respects of a, you know, it, there was a couple like in, I think it was 0.6, where there was a 36% increase in renewable energy. That's measurable, whereas a sort of a general percent increase isn't quite, for me, sort of saying enough. It would be nice to have something a little bit more robust in terms of a target of increase. But again, it is actually just a minor point, but everything else is, you know, great.
Thank you. And that did come up, didn't it, in the meeting a couple of times, that yes, we definitely need a target where we've got a percent. And I think we'll try and make that happen, won't we?
Yeah.
Okay, lovely. Anybody else? No? Well, hopefully that's a reflection of the fact that we've spent quite a bit of time over this, thrashing it about over the past couple of months. So thank you all for your input in that process. It's been very constructive. So let's move to the vote now, unless Natalie, did you want to say anything as proposer of the motion?
Only just to say thanks to all the hard work that's gone into it, and that, yeah, we should go for it. Thanks.
Thank you. So please raise your hand if you're in favour. That's everybody. Thank you very much. Okay, we'll move on to item 9, which is the Community Infrastructure Levy, SIL, and the spending allocations for financial year 22-23. And my computer's just cocked out. Right, so before I hand over to Krista, I just wanted to mention that we had a really helpful information evening with Krista, where she set out for us those proposals that had come forward this year, and those that looked likely to be recommended, and those that there were reasons perhaps not to. And a number of questions were raised in that session, which Krista has kindly followed up on since. The responses, Chris's responses to those questions, are now on the members hub for you to look at your leisure. I think a link may go out to that tomorrow as part of the Members Matter newsletter, but I will just touch on them now in case it influences anyone's decisions. So the first question was in relation to the AstroTurf at Archway. Why are we using plastic when we could be using grass? And the comment there, I mean, you please have a look at the detail, but essentially it's to do with the high use of the surface, and the fact that we're standing that high use means that they can be used both during the day by the school and by the general public as a sports resource at night. So hopefully that makes sense. There was a related question: is there not a more environmentally responsible option when we're trying to reduce our carbon footprint? The comment there, 3G pitches require very little water, so it is helpful for the environment from that point of view. There is another solution called hybrid pitch, but there isn't enough data yet to support how effective that is. So Sports England don't actually offer funding for that. And obviously this whole bid is predicated on a very sizable Sports England contribution. So that option can't be considered at this time. As part of the bid, the existing grass pitch at Archway will be moved to another location. So in effect, they're creating a new pitch while maintaining their current grass. And there's some additional detail around the lifespan of AstroTurf, which is 10 years, and the maintenance of the pitch, which I'd invite you to have a look at your leisure. The second question was in relation to the Nailsworth flood defence scheme. So members asked for details on the much larger flood defence works being undertaken as part of the Environment Agency and Gloucestershire County Council's wider scheme. And there is, again, much more detail available for you. And I'm just seeing whether there's anything that might affect tonight. The SIL funding will address some of the surface water risk impacts on the public realm, travel routes and commercial and business properties, which is outside the current scope of EA and GCC funding. The volumes of water being controlled are considerable and the necessary subsequent works are costly. The planned works will make a significant difference to managing flood risk to the Nailsworth area arising from the rivers and brooks. And then the final one was the Stratford Park outdoor pool. Members queried if other solutions for retaining temperature in the outdoor pool are also being examined, for example, perhaps polytunnel type covers. And that is the case. Officers in our facilities management services have already set up a task and finish group looking at all the improvements that could be made to the outdoor pool. And one of the areas of focus is exactly that, looking at the options for covers and tunnels to retain heat within the pool. And again, much more detail available should you want to look at it. So hopefully, I can't recall offhand who asked those specific questions, but does that give you the information that you need, or raise your hand if it doesn't, because I can read more of the information I've got in front of me if need be. Is everyone happy with that? Yes, okay, lovely. In which case, I'm going to hand over to Krista now to talk us through this report. Thank you, George.
Good evening, everybody. So my role as Senior Infrastructure Officer within the Planning Strategy Team, I oversee the administration of developer contributions. So that covers the old-fashioned style Section 106 agreements, which are still in operation for some developments, and the community infrastructure levy. So I appreciate that you probably read the report and you've attended the members' information session, but for those who haven't been able to, I'll just do a very brief overview now. So the community infrastructure levy was introduced by the government in 2010 as a mechanism to fund infrastructure required to deliver new development achieved under the local plan growth strategies. So that's a really fundamental point. And we've had a couple of community organisations perceiving this as a general grant scheme, and that's quite an error. It's really important that that this infrastructure scheme is seen as was the Section 106 function. It's a financial contribution that should be used to help make that housing development acceptable in planning terms. So when we talk about an infrastructure project aligning and helping to mitigate and satisfy pressures created by growth, what we're really saying is, if you've got a housing development of a significant size, that brings with it new population, maybe families. Those people are going to depend on local infrastructure such as local schools, roads, cycle and walking routes, emergency services. So the pressures created by that new population, those are the kind of infrastructure projects that we're looking to fund through this scheme. So as I just mentioned, SIL only partially replaces the Section 106 arrangements. And the Section 106 arrangements still exist for the really large strategic sites as identified and allocated within our district local plan. So where there are really large strategic sites, they will continue to have education contributions, recreation contributions negotiated between the developer and the district council and the county council. SIL, on the other hand, that applies to all the residential developments that are not strategic allocated sites. So they are the windfall sites or smaller developments. And the income that we take as a district council as a levy is calculated on a square meterage of the houses that are delivered. Payment is initiated once the planning permission is implemented. So once work start on ground, that means the planning permission is implemented and we can send out demand notices to the developers. Generally speaking, payments are made in three installments. So from the moment a planning permission is implemented, we might not see all of the money due for perhaps a period of a couple of years. So since we started, or since Stroud District Council started collecting SIL in April 2017, we've so far collected £9,223,485 into the strategic infrastructure budget. So we have three budgets that we collect SIL into. The strategic infrastructure budget is the largest of those. And there is also the neighbourhood portion, which is the smaller of the budgets. And that is allocated either as a 15% or a 25%, depending on whether that town or parish council has a neighbour, an adopted neighbourhood development plan. So I'm highlighting that because although we're not actually talking about allocating neighbourhood portion here, it's very important that we differentiate between what we consider to be a neighbourhood project and a strategic project. And in the case of a neighbourhood project, they are the that SIL finance is given directly to the town and parish councils for them to administer on whatever they believe to be local infrastructure priorities for their neighbourhood locality. So we have the strategic infrastructure fund. And this can be delivered on anything that we consider to be a strategic priority as identified within the planning, supporting planning documents. Principally, they are the local plan, the infrastructure delivery framework, and the infrastructure funding statement. They are the three guiding principles to which we will score and evaluate a project that is submitted to us as a bid. The infrastructure statement outlines the kinds of projects that we can fund, and that's deliberately broad. That will range again from environmental schemes to education, highways, flood defence schemes, and there's quite a few things that the infrastructure funding statement is very broad, deliberately broad, so that we can actually consider what we believe fits the planning priorities. One difficulty with SIL is, I think, before it was initiated, there was large expectations on it bringing in millions of pounds to the district. And that might be the case for really large borough councils around perhaps the London areas or Oxfordshire, where there is considerable growth. But in the Stroud district, which is still a semi-rural district with market towns, we're never going to be looking at the levels of growth that some of those larger, more metropolitan councils take in. So at the moment, we're now at a stage where planning permissions that were started in 2017 have now come to fruition. So we're now in a position to realise that we are now taking in around about £400,000 a year towards our infrastructure, towards the strategic infrastructure budget. Now, when we look at Appendix B to the report, we can see that the wish list or the needs, wants and wishes of our strategic delivery partners is considerable. There is millions and millions of pounds worth of infrastructure that is desired for our Stroud, for the Stroud district. And that's where we have to be really, again, very careful about how we align the projects that have come into us with the priorities and objectives of the infrastructure delivery plan. So even if we've got a beautiful plan or a project that we really believe in and I think is a really great project, it might not be applicable to this scheme, in which case we will do our best as a council to try and find other funding sources, or we'll write letters of support and we'll give as much project assistance as we can, but it might not be the large amounts of funding that that project might be hoping for from SIL. As again, because there's so many really important projects that we know are on the horizon, I would like to highlight again the importance of actually having some rollover towards those projects that we know are coming in future years. One particular area that we know is a pressing priority is education. And we, on that basis, we are suggesting that there is a rollover towards next year's budget. So this year we received 9 formal bids requesting funding to deliver their projects next financial year. So that's April 22 to March 23. And as a panel of officers, we've assessed the bids according to the planning priorities. And we've also enjoyed a really interesting and informative session with members, because it's really important that this is an engaged process with members and a very open and transparent process. We want everybody, the community groups, members, to feel that they understand the reasoning behind why we've allocated money in certain areas and why we're suggesting either a rollover or that some project, and in this case, some projects are put on pending further feasibility work. So out of the 9 bids, we are recommending to Environment Committee, which will then go on to Strategy and Resources in January, that we fully fund the Nailsworth Flood Prevention and Drainage Scheme, which is £52,500. We also fully support the requested funding of £150,000 towards the Archway School 3G AstroTurf pitch. And that project is particularly exciting because by actually committing £150,000 of our SIL money, we are securing the inward investment of over £600,000 from Sports England, which is potentially a fantastic achievement. We are also recommending £10,000 towards Stratford Park's outdoor pool heat exchange, which promises to increase the temperature of the outdoor pool by round about 3 degrees. That will not only just improve user comfort, but it will help alleviate some pressures on the indoor pool by allowing exercise classes and lane swimming on the outdoor pool to take place, and also increase the opening time of the outdoor pool by allowing it to open earlier and close later in the day, and also open earlier in the season and close later in the year. That promises to be a quick win for the district, whereby if committee choose to approve that project, then we are anticipating that the works could be delivered very early in next year, and potentially delivering those heat improvements to the public ready for next season's opening. There are a couple of projects that I mentioned that are good projects, and they are considered to be priority infrastructure. However, there were elements of those projects that we felt didn't meet the scheme's criteria in terms of either satisfying the planning requirements of growth, meeting the needs of growth, or that the projects themselves were just simply in the very early stages of development, and there were elements of the feasibility studies or business plan that needed further information. And we've gone back to those organisations asking for that further information, but because like I say, because the bids were at an early stage, that information is not yet available. And without that information, we as a council are going to be, we're going to find it very difficult to recommend funding on that basis. So I think that covers most things that I wanted to say. I'm happy to take any questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Krista. I'd just like to say thank you so much for working in such a positive and active way with members. It's really appreciated.
Thank you very much.
Hopefully it's given us all a really good understanding of the projects that we're considering tonight. So thank you.
Thank you.
Councillor Tipper.
Thank you for your presentation, Krista. It certainly explains SIL a bit better than I used to understand it to be. But you'll have to excuse my sort of naive way of looking at it. And to be honest with you, when SIL came out, there were going to be winners and losers. There was going to be money raised in one area and spent in another, which is not the complete opposite of Section 106, in my mind. And all I'm trying to say is that I'm not too sure, but perhaps the schemes that you've identified are more a town than they are rural. In other words, is it going to be arguable that the rural areas are going to dip out? And what worries a lot of people is that the money will be raised, say, you know, in Dursley, and spent, say, in Frampton, or Frampton's a village. But do you understand where I'm coming from?
Absolutely.
And I'll be honest with you.
Yeah.
You kept on using the word broad in terms of the conditions, and the spectrum was broad. So what I'm trying to say is, when things become broad, the arguments become very difficult, you know, to understand, and could be, for the want of a better word, used, you know, to how can I put it, to qualify one place as opposed to another, and that's what concerns me greatly, in terms of in particular CAM. We've had a lot of development there, and are we? A classic example would be that the houses that have been built, the Section 106 money, I want to go, use that as an example, was frankly not very high at all. There were arguments put against, for instance, we were asking for money to spend on Cam and Dursley. But the argument by people developing right next door to the Cam and Dursley station says, well, we're not benefiting from the station. Mm. But in real terms, the people are buying those houses simply because they are next door to the station. So, you know, there's a very diverse argument as to why the money should or shouldn't be spent next door to where it was raised. So I'm not sort of, I'd be watching the SIL project, if you like, with very, very closely, simply because I talk about it in my mind. There's winners and losers, and the winners will be the people who got these projects going, like the AstroTurf and that type of thing. And then there will be the losers. That's the people that raise the money. But it's not spent in their area. So I would like to think there's going to be a balance of the money that certain areas receive as against the money that was raised in that area, you know, to do it. That is my criticism and my viewpoint about SIL. It is not as accurate, if you like, as the Section 106 system. I hope I've made some points, but I must admit I'm quite naive in terms of the arguments, and thank you for the presentation, and it helped, but not entirely. Thank you very much.
You make the point very well, and I sound a bit sort of smug and confident in saying this, but I think actually if you were to sit and look at the way that we actually look at the projects and align them to growth, which is what I was trying to stress before. You were just saying about the growth in CAM. So we are specifically looking at the areas that have experienced that growth, and we are looking to very much so place the funding into infrastructure projects that directly mitigate against the impacts of that growth. That is exactly what we're about here, and that is exactly what we're trying to achieve. And I understand your concerns, and when I first heard of SILT, that was absolutely one of my concerns. Now that we are a few years down the process, and we can look at we can analyse the figures, and we can look at exactly which parishes are having the SILT income, we are able to see exactly where those growth areas are. And following committee, I'd like to send you a little bit more information on that, which I think you'll find interesting. So you'll be interested to see that the other developments in CAM, I think Box Road is quite a large one, that has attracted significant amounts of SIL. And we will be working absolutely to ensure that there's some really good projects delivered in that area. I know for a fact that the CAM and Dursley area are looking to have classroom expansions and education places developed in the Tilsdown area, and in schools in CAM and Dursley. You mentioned about the train station. Indeed, that was a project you'll see on Appendix A, I think it was. Beg your pardon, it's item 11B. Of last year's funding, some money was put to the train station to improve user comfort to the train station for people with that are walking and cycling and want to feel safer at the train station. In fact, I only sent an email yesterday to an environmental organisation saying that we would like them to have a look at opportunities for environmental improvements, tree planting, and improvements to green space within the CAM parish area. So I hope that goes some way to answering your question, but I'm extremely passionate about making sure that the winners are those communities that have experienced the growth and therefore need that infrastructure. In fact, I'd go as far as to say that is the bottom line of our job. That is our legislative responsibility in the application of these funds. Thank you. And just sorry, I missed the other point of your question about my use of the word broad. When I used the word broad, that was in terms of this prescriptive list in the infrastructure funding statement of the types of projects that we can apply the money towards. So when I say broad, it doesn't mean just kind of broad application of the money across the district. It means the types of projects. So it means that we, as a council, we can be quite flexible in what we believe to be our infrastructure priorities. So that could be an extension towards the fire station, it could be education classrooms, it could be tree planting. The scope of projects is broad, but not necessarily the geographical application of funding. Thank you.
Thank you, Krista. That was really helpful. Robin.
Hi, thanks, Krista, for your excellent and detailed presentation and your comprehensive explanation of what is quite a complex issue. I really welcome these projects. I think they're all very well rounded and deserve our support. I just wanted to touch on Stratford Park Outdoor Pool. I know there was a call for that last year. People wanted it to stay open longer in the season because they're using it a lot. So this will obviously benefit that. You mentioned in your presentation an investment of £10,000, but on our document it says £20,000. I just wanted to confirm that's the figure.
Ooh. I beg your pardon. Yes, that's a really good point. The bid started off as £10,000, and they then asked that the facilities team asked if it could go up to £20,000. They are actually, that is because they are currently working with the engineers to get in a formal quote. So the actual amount requested is £20,000. So I apologise for that error.
That's great. I just wanted to be sure. Thanks, Krista.
Thank you. Well spotted. Martin.
Yeah, quick sort of follow-up to Councillor Tipper's question. Do I understand correctly that either 25 or 15% of the sill raised goes to the parish or town council, depending whether they have an NDP or not?
Correct. Yeah, so 15% if the town or parish council does not have an adopted neighbourhood development plan. If it has an NDP that has been formally adopted by council, then it would get 25% of the sums accrued. The money that goes to town and parish councils is given to the town and parish council, or they have the option to have it twice a year, which is prescribed by legislation. If a town and parish council hasn't actually had that much, so say, for example, they've only had £80 in that 6 month period, that town or parish council could choose to roll that over until the next 6 months so that they can build up a little bit more of a significant sum, because obviously you can't spend £80 on very much. But where a town or parish council does have a reasonable amount, say a few thousand pounds, we do encourage them to take that money and spend it on a local project. And we've actually we've got information on the website, and it's coming out in this December's infrastructure funding statement report that we're required to publish every December. There's examples and more details of what the town and parish councils have been spending that neighbourhood portion on, and there's some really nice projects that have been delivered.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Any other questions for Krista? Hayden.
Thank you. This is from my namesake, Hayden Sutton, who couldn't make it tonight. And this might come down to our lack of familiarity with the Stroud April Pool, which has been spoken about already. Is there a combined heat and power source there already? I don't know. Because it says that the bid is for a heat exchanger to go on that to use the waste heat. So that's the first question. And the other point, I mentioned it earlier on, and Mike Towson referenced it as well. The reference to Frampton, development of a new waste site at Frampton, is on page 83 in that table there. So it's £300,000, and that's to do with Gossington, not Frampton. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Krista, are you happy to address those?
I might, if it's okay, pass the first question about Stratford Park outdoor pool and the CHP to Mike, if that's okay. Thank you.
There is a CHP unit within Stratford Park Leisure Centre, and the idea would be to connect across. So yes, we have one in the Stratford Park Leisure Centre, as we do in the Pulse in the Safer District.
Yeah. Just follow up on that, just it's a bit specific, and Krista won't know this, I don't think, but what's the heat source? Does it burn pellets or coal? I don't know, what is burnt in that combined heat and power unit?
If I remember rightly, it's to do with the electricity and gas, not electricity. So it reduces the electricity usage. I can get you more detail on it, but both sites work on the same principle.
Thank you. I think there is a bit more on the members' hub on the papers there about it. But if not, we can pick it up later. Councillor Tipper.
Just a quick one, Chair. To Martin's point, the way he put the question, about up to 25% of the sale money stays locally, which is how I understood it. But conversely, up to 75% is going out of the area and could be spent elsewhere. So that's the point I'm trying to make, is that there's winners and losers. So in other words, if we raised, say, 100%, 25% can come back to the parish, but the 75%, can come down to decisions made by Stroud District Council. That is the point I'm trying to raise and make with regard to the SIL, the situation. So an area that that has raised the money doesn't get it or all of it. So it, you know, that's the difference between Section 106 and sale.
I think we all acknowledge that, and I mean, Krista, you work very proactively, don't you, with the strategic partners. Perhaps it's something we could all do in our own parishes, is encourage, you know, where parish councils aren't already applying for SIL, you know, talk to them about the projects that they could be identifying and taking forward, because, you know, we can only in this committee choose from the pool that have applied. There are 9 projects, and, you know, we are supporting all the ones that meet the criteria, so would welcome more coming forward, I think. Is that right, Krista?
That is correct to a certain degree, but we do again have to be quite careful that any projects that are being put forward to us by any organisation, whether it's a town or parish council, that project is seen to be strategic. And when we say strategic, we mean that that facility or that the function of that infrastructure would satisfy a population or a significant population outside of that immediate area. So if a town or parish council was to recommend a project that would only principally benefit the users of that locality, then we would consider that to be a neighbourhood project and it would not be eligible for the strategic infrastructure fund. So a classic example of that would be a local village hall. If unless your village hall is used by 75% of people outside of your village, which is unlikely of a village hall, then that would be a local neighbourhood project. So we have to be quite careful about the use and implementation of strategic funding for strategic uses. I hope that made sense.
Thank you for clarifying that. That's very helpful. Shall we move forward to the decision at this point? Yes. So I'll read that out. The committee recommends to Strategy and Resources Committee funding commitments are agreed according to the report. Do we have a proposer for that? Tricia, thank you. And the seconder? Ashley, thank you. Did you want to speak, Ashley? No? Okay. In that case, do we have any further comments in debate? Tricia?
I'd just like to echo thanks everybody's already said for Krista's obviously excellent level of knowledge on the subject and the time that she spent on the information session, answering the questions tonight and the questions that we put to her in the information sessions. I certainly feel I've got a better understanding of the conflicts allocations and priorities that and the decision-making process. And based on all that, I'm totally supportive of everything that she's recommended today. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and I'm sure we all feel the same. So let's move to the vote then, unless anyone else has a comment. No? Okay. Please raise your hand if you're in favour. Lovely, that's unanimous. Thank you very much. Now, it's nearly 9:15. I'm conscious we've been going for over 2 hours now. We are on the home straight, but should we take a couple of minutes for a comfort break just before we do the last couple of items? Okay, thank you. So if we come back at 9:20, if that's all right.
Thank you very much. It feels really, really so supported by members. It's really nice. And this is exactly what the democratic process is about, like officers working with members to get exactly the right result. Yeah. So I'm really pleased. And I would definitely do the information session again. I just really enjoy working with members to get the right result. It's really good.
Sounds great.
Yeah, well, thank you for your support. Thank you.
Are we ready to resume? Thank you, everyone. So we'll go on to item 10 now, which is the establishment of the Strategic Planning Advisory Board. And I'm going to pass over to Brendan to present this one.
Thank you, Chair. Very briefly, as you can see, it's a brief covering report here, but an important item for you to consider this evening. So as you can see in the covering report and in the Appendix A, the Strategic Planning Advisory Board will act as an officer and member working group, considering matters of strategic planning policy, reviewing their implementation, and recommending accordingly to Environment Committee. So I think the key first point I'd make is this is an advisory body, not a decision-making body. It links very closely to this committee, which of course is the decision maker, but that it's really drawing that clear relationship between this working group and this committee. Just to emphasise that there's a name change recommended in the report. So formerly this was known as the Planning Review Panel. Excuse me. and that panel always considered matters of strategic planning policy. So the name change is really to reflect that, to make it clearer. Excuse me.
Can you give
some water? Yeah. None left in there. So. Where was I? so yeah, formerly known as the PRP, focused on matters of strategic planning policy. Terms of reference, hopefully is self-explanatory, but focuses on the role, membership, and the relationship to this committee. So I commend it to you. I'll probably stop talking now because I'm running out of words, but happy to take any questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Brendan. Norman.
Thank you, Chair. I've had a conversation with Brendan, and I think you copied into that, over the issue of confidentiality. And the recommendation is that the board's meetings will be confidential, whereas I argued that it should be confidential within council. And my understanding of Brendan's answer is, in effect, that is the case, that if I wanted to discuss something with my group leader on this issue, then that's fine or so on. And I just really wanted to get confirmation through you, Chair, that when it says confidential, it means that other members of council can be advised of it, but they hold that confidentiality requirement as well.
Thank you. And I think, Brendan, you confirmed that, didn't you? That
I did indeed, yes.
Yeah.
And confidential in this context means not shared with the public, but sharing with councillors in confidence is, of course, absolutely fine. Sorry for my loss of voice as well earlier.
That's great. And we'll make sure that's reflected in the minutes as well, Norman. Anybody else? Did I see your hand, Ashley? No, sorry. Yes, Hayden.
Thanks. And thanks, Brendan. I sat on the PRP since its inception, whenever that was. And we did talk about things beyond strategic matters, including enforcement and our success with appeals on individual applications and things like that. So I'm mildly concerned about the fact that we will presume just be limited to strategic matters according to the new title. Can you just comment on that?
Yes, and I should have drawn attention onto bullet point 3 in the functions listed on the appendix, which does actually talk about reviewing planning appeal decisions, which have key implications for the council's strategic planning. So there will be where those appeal decisions have implications for our policies, that's within the remit of this new board. And I think that was my understanding is though that was the same with the former with the PRP as was. So that won't change. Hope that clarifies.
Did you want to say a few words about the other additional governance that will be happening within planning and with the members of the DCC committee as well?
absolutely. Thanks, Chair. Yes, I mean, in the covering report, I covered this in one of the paragraphs, just to acknowledge that, you know, I'm certainly aware that there are concerns, members have raised concerns about development management and enforcement. And I think some of members here tonight will have attended the Audit and Standards Committee on the 30th of November, where there was a really detailed report on enforcement and also another one on a broader one on development management more generally. So in my covering report, I do talk about a separate body looking at development management being established. That will obviously be connected more closely to Development Control Committee as the responsible committee on matters around development management. So that's just to say that group will be established and a report will be coming to DCC in the early new year on the establishment of that group in a similar format with the terms of reference set up to cover those concerns. Thank you.
Thank you. Is that okay, or did you want to ask anything else?
I've got some points I'd like to make, but probably not questions though, so I'll wait for debate if you like.
Ashley.
Mine was quite a simple one, just for a point of reference, Hayden. It's paragraph 2.2 of the document pack is the body that Brendan's referring to.
Anybody else? No? Okay. In which case, I'll read the decision. The committee resolves to A, establish the Strategic Planning Advisory Board, and B, approve the draft terms of reference for the proposed new board attached as Appendix A. Do we have a proposer? Ashley, thank you. And a seconder? Thank you, Natalie. Do you wish to speak, Natalie? No? Okay. In which case, I will open it up to debate. And Hayden, did you want to?
Thank you. The original PRP was brought in primarily as a way to help inform the draft local plan process, really, as it went through. Many of those of us that sat on the PRP, we debated things at length, and in terms of the confidentiality, I think it was a good thing because it allowed people to perhaps be a little bit more open than they might otherwise be. For various reasons on camera. I note your caution there, Norman, but I think it benefited all of us that took part in it. The concern I would have is that the draft local plan that began to form in around 2017, despite the input of PRP, it would have been recognisable and the one that we voted on in April this year. There really wasn't much of a change. Maybe some language was nuanced a little bit. Mark might challenge this, so I'm sure you'll talk with him about it, and he might challenge this. But I would say myself, and from those from my party and other parties, felt that apart from some nuance to language, there wasn't a great deal of change, particularly with the strategic sites. They were fairly well formed in 2017, and as it went through, they stayed and didn't change, no matter what we did. This might be a bit different in that we aren't at the same stage with the local plan now. That's off with the inspector, and we'll wait and see what that inspector says. I'm not quite sure what I'm trying to say here, but it's it'll be important that the views that we discuss at this new Strategic Planning Advisory Board, we might need to find a mechanism whereby we feed that back into our groups. I know that was a bit of a challenge previously to make sure that we can align officers' thoughts with the political groups, because many felt that it wasn't achieved properly by PRP previously. Mark might have a different view, but I think some of those of us, I'm not sure there's anybody here that's, no, some of the previous PRP members were frustrated by how it was very difficult to get some of the things that we had great concerns about changed. There was one change which was achieved partly by PRP, but it was a little bit, officers were dragged kicking and screaming, I would have to say, with regard to development of small sites in particularly rural locations where we wanted to try and generate some sustainability in small locations where we felt that pubs and post offices and people that wanted to stay in the village where they grew up, that was a bit of a change, but beyond that, it was difficult. So I hope this is that we can see some of the discussions here fed through into the political groups and come into whatever planning changes there are in the future.
Thank you very much. Anybody else? No? Okay. Right. Well, and just to say to that, I very much hope that as well. I mean, we want this body to be a useful, you know, a useful body that, you know, informs our wider debate and hopefully, you know, brings positive change. So I'm keen to work together on that. In which case, Ashley, did you want to say anything as a proposer?
Yeah, I mean, I don't wish to repeat the points you've already made, Chair, but I think certainly my own political group and those within the Alliance will know that this is something I was particularly passionate about and wanted to see return, albeit in a, you know, with a name change and a slight rebranding. I'm personally very happy with the terms of reference, and I think I'm particularly pleased that sort of coming from audit last week or 2 weeks ago, that we equally have the development management side of things also under that sort of scrutiny and allowing that relationship and conversation to have or take place in an informal setting. I also quite like the fact that this isn't necessarily just to do with the local plan, that we also have planning appeals in there and also the consultation exercises, thinking hypothetically, should the Glover review ever move towards being implemented, those sort of discussions, we'd have a very early opportunity for us to discuss across party political lines. So I'd recommend everyone to support this. I think it's very good. And if you're as slightly hawkish on this as I am, and I'm supporting it, I would encourage you to do so as well.
Thanks, Ashley. Okay, it doesn't look like we've got anyone else wanting to speak, so let's move to the vote then. Please raise your hand if you're in favour. Lovely, another unanimous one, thank you. Great, okay, let's move on then to item 11, which is the reports. So the first one being the planning review panel, which thanks to what we've just voted on, no longer exists. With your permission, we'll remove that report from our subsequent work plan. And we move then to the Stroud Regeneration Committee. So Robin, would you like to say a few words?
Yes, apologies members. I didn't submit a written report, but I will do for the future regeneration meetings. We had a meeting in October and we discussed budget investments in air quality monitoring, Christmas lights, the town centre cleanup, and development of the subrooms forecourt. So subrooms forecourt and Wallbridge Green are areas of special concern to Stroud regeneration. Officers informed us that new welcome signage was going in across Stroud in the car parks, that an application has been made to the Levelling Up Fund to develop the subs forecourt, that they were going to put on the Stroud social event, which I gather was very successful. I think past it when it was on, it looked pretty popular. And that they're developing, the Cornhill Marketplace. There's an event called Cornhill Seatery once a week. It's just a gathering. People turn up for tea and cake, and they put bunting in there to make it more welcoming. So it's quite a nice activity. And finally, we discussed the Rotary Club had come to us the previous meeting to with a proposal to spruce up Stroud, a wide range of activities across Stroud. We'll discuss that in some detail. Here ends my report.
Lovely, thank you, Robin. So C is the performance monitoring report. So this was the last report on the old performance indicators. And Natalie, I think you're going to say a few words on that.
Thanks, Chair. I met with Brendan along with Tom from the Youth Council on the 18th of November. So it was really good to see Tom there, actually. Yeah, and he asked some really good questions. So we went through the report. And obviously, this is the last one now. We'll be moving forward to the new format for the next meeting. So looking forward to that, actually. So
it's just a very short feedback, really.
Thank you. And is it going to be standard for Tom to be involved, or is that a one-off? It'd be nice if he was involved in that, in a new report when it comes along.
Yeah, I think ongoing.
Yes, it's definitely intended to keep the Youth Council involved in the performance monitoring work of the council. So yeah, definitely with Tom, and I can't remember his colleague on the Youth Council, what she was called, but she couldn't make the meeting, but she'll be involved as well.
Eight, I think.
So yeah, absolutely. That's the plan.
Excellent. Thank you. So the last item was, Krista mentioned this earlier, just it's an information sheet, which just is a progress report really on prior year SIL projects for your information. Any questions on that one? No. If you when you have a chance to look at it, if you want to feed anything back to Krista, please do. So moving on to item 12, our work programme, you'll see that our next meeting, which is in February, is extremely light at the moment. It's just the reports coming to it. So, I mean, feel free to chip in with ideas if you wish to. Unfortunately, we've got really quite a full agenda in March, but those items don't necessarily lend themselves to pulling forward. So we can take a view, I think it's mid-January when we have to make a decision. We could cancel the February meeting if nothing emerges that needs dealing with. But equally, if there are things you'd like to suggest today for February, then please do. Yes, Hayden.
Sorry to come back to this, Brendan, but in March, the Severn Estuary Mitigation Strategy was one of the subjects we were going to be talking about. I hope, further to our conversation earlier on, we can talk about that in January with Brendan and Mark. And I hope we can make some sort of progress on working out where we're going with this. So we might have something more to report by the 3rd of February. But I'm happy to take your comments, Brendan.
I think certainly we'll have that session we talked about earlier, that informal discussion with you, Chloe and Hayden, and I think Norman, just to unpick that information report a bit more. I'm not confident there'll be a report for any report for decision, however, in on the 3rd of February to the committee itself. So, but we can certainly have the discussion in January, I'd suggest, about the information item and, you know, unpack that a bit more, if that's okay. But I can't see a decision item coming in February.
No, I appreciate that. But Norman and I, going back, we had quite long discussions on a bit of a plan on how we would like to see it go forward. You and Mark and whoever else may disagree with that. But I hope we could knock it around and see whether the ideas that we had are still legitimate. The way, I'm not saying all other councils are right, but they have made a lot of progress, and there seems to be action taking place that has been a bit lacking here. I know we produced a report, and I know we were very keen to make sure there was much more member involvement and some sort of democratic involvement on a regular basis, rather than it being agreed at a committee and then left with officers forever, because that isn't how it works elsewhere, and it seems to be quite successful elsewhere. And talking about learning from best practice elsewhere, I hope that's what we can do. And Norman and I did talk about this with Mark previously, and I hope we can knock that back and forth and perhaps go some way towards what we were hoping to achieve. So if we can meet with you, Chloe, in January sometime, we might be able to, you know, add some more meat to the bones of our ideas.
Great, thank you, Brendan. Yeah. Brian.
Yeah, just a quick one, Chair. With regard to the work programme, I would like to think there was some kind of mechanism that if any of us thought of something to go on the work programme, there was a mechanism that we could put that forward to the group and either adopt it or do whatever we need to do to it, rather than wait until the next meeting to introduce it. Let's be a bit more efficient, you know, with regard to using the time.
Absolutely, and feel free to send ideas to me or send them to Becky, or completely, if something comes up between, you know, now and February, very happy to look at it. Yes, Norman.
Two things. Firstly, Chair, can we remove from reports from future meetings the second one, which is report on the Glover review
I raised this at least 6 months ago and we agreed to remove it, but it's still there. So if you could arrange to do that. The second one, and I suspect that I'm a voice of just one ear, I think we're missing the opportunity again to put a firmer grip on the issue of air quality in the district. We've had a briefing on it, but I'm still of the view after reassurances that we still fail to monitor particulates, particularly PM10, PM2.5, which PM2.5 is able to get straight into the lungs. That's not monitored anywhere in the country, very few places in the country. We seem to rely on nitrogen oxide as being a direct correlation, and I don't think they are. So we need to get a better grip on that. And the other thing we miss are reports on that are dealt with by the Environment Agency, perhaps well, perhaps not very well, but we need to include that in our report. So we've got a comprehensive report on air quality management in the district. For instance, firms for which we give permits, or no, firms that are obtaining permits for emissions, but we don't monitor it in any way and we don't report on it. We should do that, Chair.
Thank you, Norman. On your latter point, I did feed that back actually after the information session we had, that it would have been useful to have some of the EA data in there as well. I mean, it's freely available, so we, you know, be good to talk about it. On your first point, and I know Brendan brought this up when we discussed this previously, we, you know, there isn't a decision to be made, which is why it's not on the work plan. If you wanted us to look at, for example, some additional monitoring stations that would, you know, deal with smaller particulates, we could perhaps ask Dave to look at that and come up with some numbers for us. I know that the monitors are extremely expensive, so I think that's why we don't monitor more, but we can certainly, we could look into that if that,
that
would
be helpful, Chair.
Yeah.
We almost decided to monitor PM2.5 in Dudbridge, because that was a reading that was coming close to the 40 micro what's it, but we didn't, because the lockdown intervened. But nevertheless, it's an area which we, in my view, neglect.
So, I mean, perhaps if you could set out what you would like to see, and then we could perhaps get Dave to give us an idea of the cost. I mean, we're at the, you know, right stage in the budget process, aren't we? And we can have a look at it. Okay, thank you. Anybody else? Tricia? And then I'll come to you.
I'm referring to the March meeting where we've tabled litter bin policy. I think we all agree it's bigger than just a litter bin policy. So can we perhaps flesh that out a bit more, particularly with the points that those gentlemen raised, to do with try and recycle more? Because I know there's a lot of recycling bins that aren't used for recycling, and it's actually looking at that broader picture.
So it's probably a question for Mike rather than our work plan.
Fact it says litter bin.
That's what it's currently called. So I'm slightly wary of changing his exercise. But I'm very happy to pick up with Mike whether his exercise could be a bit broader than just litter
bin. He certainly indicated it was part of this in response to the question. That's why I want clarification on it. So if you can take that, that's fine. Or if you want me to go to Mike, that's fine too.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, lovely. And Ashley?
I wish this was a slightly more inspiring contribution, but it was just a question I should probably know the answer to, which we have planning review panel on there twice. Are we taking it as sort of read that we're replacing that with a report from the planning advisory board?
Yes, yeah, we'll tidy that up. Thank you. No, it's helpful. Thanks. Sorry, anybody else? Nope, all getting a bit tired. okay, lovely. Well, we haven't got any members' questions, so that brings us to a close. So thank you very much for your participation tonight, and don't forget to check your pigeonhole on the way out, and see you in February.